Have you ever stopped to think about how an entire country keeps track of its money? I'm not talking about its own budget, but every single dollar, euro, or yen that flows in and out from trade and investment all over the world. It's kind of like a massive national financial diary. And today, we're going to learn exactly how to read it.
So really, how does a country do that? How do you track every single dollar that crosses the border? I mean, it seems impossibly complex, right? You've got companies importing huge machines, you've got tourists swiping their credit cards, investors buying up local companies. Well, believe it or not, there's a system for all of it, a very specific and really important national ledger.
So here's how we're going to tackle this. First, we'll get the official name for this money tracking tool. Then, we'll go over the basic rules of the game, debits and credits. After that, we'll dive into the two main buckets where everything gets sorted, the current and financial accounts, and we'll use some simple examples. And finally, we'll add it all up to get the bottom line.
Okay, let's start with the tool itself. This is what economists and governments all over the world use to keep an eye on every transaction. And honestly, it's the key to understanding a country's financial health and its relationship with, well, everyone else.
It's called the balance of payments. And the most important phrase here, the one you absolutely have to remember, is with the rest of the world. This whole system only cares about international transactions. So if a local bakery buys flour from a local mill, nope, that doesn't make the cut. But if that same bakery imports chocolate from Belgium, ah, now that's exactly what we're talking about.
To really get a handle on this national ledger, we need to know how it's organized. Every single one of those international transactions gets sorted into one of two major accounts. Just think of them as two different chapters in that financial diary we mentioned.
And here they are, the current account and the financial account. The easiest way to think about it is like this. The current account is like your daily spending and income. It's for the stuff we buy and sell, you know, goods, services, that kind of thing. The financial account, on the other hand, is more like a country's investment portfolio. It tracks the buying and selling of assets, like stocks, bonds, or even entire companies.
And this right here is a simple ledger we're going to build out together. Look, it's super straightforward. We'll have a description of the deal, we'll decide which account it belongs in, and then we'll figure out if it's a debit, which just means money is leaving the country, or a credit, meaning money is coming into the country. So let's start filling this thing out.
All right, we'll start with the current account, and we're going to look at a few examples where money is flowing out of our country. So these are all going to be debits.
First up, a local company, we'll call it Fox, buys $25 million worth of machinery from another country. So let's think this through. Fox is buying a physical good, which makes it an import. And to pay for it, money has to flow out of our country. That makes this a $25 million debit in the current account. Easy enough, right?
Okay, here's another one. A big one. The government buys airplanes from a foreign company for $250 million. Just like the machinery, these are goods being imported. So once again, money is flowing out of the country to pay for them. That's another debit, right in the current account.
Now for something a little different. Our government gives a $20 million grant to Nepal. This isn't for a product or a service. It's basically a gift, a one-way payment. The fancy term for this is a unilateral transfer. But the main rule still applies. Is money leaving our country? Yes, it is. So you got it. It's another debit in the current account.
So let's take a look at our ledger. We've got our three transactions, and they all have one thing in common. Money left the country. They're all debits in the current account, adding up to a total outflow of $295 million so far.
But of course, it's not a one-way street. Money doesn't just flow out. It also flows in. So let's switch gears to the financial account and look at a deal that brings foreign money into the country.
Okay, here's the deal. A big foreign company, let's say Apple, buys a local startup for $99 million. So what's happening with the money here? A foreign company is sending its cash into our economy to buy an asset, the startup. This is classic foreign investment. And because money is coming in, it's a credit. And since it's an investment, it goes into the financial account.
Let's check back in with our ledger. Ah, now we've got some action on both sides of the sheet. We have three debits over in the current account for goods and aid, and now we have this one big credit in the financial account for that investment. See? The full picture is starting to come together.
Okay, time for a little pop quiz. A local insurance company buys $200 million worth of bonds, but they buy them on the local Tel Aviv stock exchange. So, where does this go on our sheet? Is it a debit, a credit, current account, or financial account?
What do you think? And the answer is, it's a trick question. It goes nowhere. This transaction does not get recorded in the balance of payments. Why? Because it's a purely domestic deal. One local company bought something from another local entity. No money actually crossed any international borders. This is the perfect example of that number one rule. It only counts if the money flows between our country and the rest of the world.
All right, we've sorted through all our international deals. We know what's in, we know what's out, and we know what doesn't even count. Now it's time for the moment of truth. Let's do the math and find out the bottom line. What's the final score for our country?
So here it is, our final completed ledger. On the debit side, all the money that went out, we have a total of $295 million. And on the credit side, all the money that came in, we have $99 million.
And wow, when you see it as a bar chart like this, the difference is really stark, isn't it? That blue bar for debits, the money that left, is towering over the green bar for credits, the money that came in. That's a pretty big gap.
So what is that final balance? We take the $99 million that came in, subtract the $295 million that went out, and that leaves us with negative $196 million. That's our bottom line.
But what does a negative number like that actually mean in the real world? Well, it means that to cover that $196 million difference, the country had to dip into its savings of foreign money, its reserves. The books always have to balance, one way or another. And since more money went out than came in, the difference had to come out of the nation's own piggy bank.
And that brings us to the really big question, doesn't it? We ended up with a deficit, more money left than came in. But is that automatically a bad thing? Well, not necessarily. A fast-growing country might run a deficit because it's importing tons of machinery to build new factories. A really wealthy country might have a deficit because its people are investing all over the world. The number itself doesn't tell you the whole story. The real work is in understanding the story behind the number.